For many people, Saudi Arabia is known for its oil, the pool of liquid that has brought wealth to the authoritarian-led absolute monarchy. But there is another valuable resource beneath the dry Arabian desert, namely groundwater, which enables huge agricultural areas to be cultivated in the middle of the desert. There are only 18 countries on the planet without rivers. Saudi Arabia is by far the largest of them. The case with a lot of these countries is that they are small island nations that often do not have high landforms where rivers could arise. In the Gulf region, it's a different story. Here, the landscape is characterized by the Arabian Desert. By definition, a river is a permanently flowing body of water. In Saudi Arabia, there are so-called wadis. These are dried up riverbeds, some of them through which water flows seasonally. For example, the Wadi Hanifa, which runs through the country's capital Riyadh. This map shows elevation in Saudi Arabia. The Asir Mountains stretch along the coast to the Red Sea. Here, the climate is cooler, and during the Indian Ocean's monsoon season, there is significant rain in this area, as visible by this precipitation map. Due to water scarcity, it is an enormous challenge for Saudi Arabia to maintain agriculture and avoid being almost completely dependent on imports. In order to more efficiently use rainfall for agriculture and water supply, several dams were built, especially in the southwest of the country, creating reservoirs. Noteworthy is the Beish Dam, as well as the King Fahad Dam, which has the largest reservoir in the country. In the rest of the country, rain is both rare and irregular, and is therefore not sufficient for maintaining profitable livestock and agriculture. In the 1970s and 1980s, there was a political desire to gain self-sufficiency, and the country pushed ahead with a number of initiatives to modernize the agricultural sector. And if you look at the desert from space, you now see large agricultural areas full of crop circles that result from the center pivot irrigation. The water required for this is pumped from deep below the surface, from aquifers that filled up during the Ice Age, when climate in this region was significantly cooler. With the help of this water, which accumulated thousands of years ago, large areas can be used for agriculture. But there are also lots of difficulties. After all, the groundwater in this region is virtually non-renewable because there hardly is any rain. Saudi Arabia is suffering from a rapid depletion of water in its underground aquifers, and the country's agriculture sector is disintegrating. The groundwater level at the Al-Asa aquifer has dropped by 150 meters, which is about 490 feet, within just 25 years. And the circular green fields in the desert are rapidly fading. In 2008, Saudi Arabia had to adjust course. They gave up on the idea of turning their deserts into fertile farmland. This statistic shows the annual wheat production in Saudi Arabia. The reforms of the 1980s led to an immense increase, but ever since 2008, this number went completely down. And when we lay over the amount of imported wheat, we see the change in strategy that occurred in 2008. The Initiative for Agricultural Investment Abroad was launched. The goal is to buy and manage land in other countries in order to save water at home. Saudi food companies are acquiring farmland in Argentina and through subsidiary companies in Arizona and California. They mainly grow alfalfa hay, which is then imported to Saudi Arabia and used as cow feed. And by doing it this way, they don't have to stress their own aquifers so much. So essentially, they are importing water. They also lease land in Sudan, as well as in Zambia and to a large extent in Ethiopia. There already is a lease between the Saudi Star PLC for an area of 140,000 hectares in Ethiopia, and the long-term goal of the Saudi company is to rent up to 500,000 hectares. Such investments can create water conflict, as many of the regions in which land is leased already suffer from water shortages themselves. To guarantee water supply for its citizens, Saudi Arabia is also heavily investing in seawater desalination. It is now the largest producer of desalinated water in the world. So for example, the majority of water in Medina is pumped there from a desalination plant on the Red Sea. Drinking water in the capital Riyadh mainly comes from the Jubail desalination plant on the Persian Gulf, roughly 500 kilometers or 310 miles away, from where it is pumped inland via pipeline. And as of January 2019, this plant alone produces around 1.4 million cubic meters of water every single day. The water supply in Saudi Arabia is heavily subsidized. The government has commissioned a number of private companies from all over the world for these desalination plants. In order to keep the costs low for the consumer, the government buys the water from these companies and sells it to households at a significantly lower price. There are efforts to increase these household tariffs in order to create more incentives for water saving, but a tariff increase is unpopular. And the last time tariffs were raised in 2016, the price increase led to an uproar and the eventual replacement of the water minister. A common method for desalination of seawater is through thermal desalination. There are a number of different technical processes here, but basically it is achieved by boiling water and therefore separating it from the salt. The other more energy efficient method is desalination through reverse osmosis. In reverse osmosis, the seawater is pressurized and forced through a membrane which only lets through the water molecules and therefore separates them from the salt. Currently, about half of the drinking water in Saudi Arabia comes from desalination. But as plausible as desalination may seem, there are a number of disadvantages to it, especially in terms of its environmental impact. A byproduct of the desalination process is brine, which is the heavy salt concentration liquid that is left over at the end. This wastewater brine is usually returned to the ocean, where it can create environmental damage. Saudi Arabia is able to desalinate large amounts of water because it can produce the necessary energy using fossil fuels. In thermal desalination, fossil fuels are used to generate the necessary heat. And in reverse osmosis, the electricity necessary is largely produced using natural gas. So these are not particularly sustainable approaches to solve the water problem. Saudi Arabia is therefore also investing in solar-powered desalination plants, such as the world's largest in Kafji. But the country is still very dependent on fossil fuels and fossil waters. And the importance of finding sustainable solutions to these enormous challenges is demonstrated by the depletion of groundwater levels in the previous decades.